to welcome Sophia Powell, who is the curator of the Cooper Gallery at Duncan of Jordan School, College of Art and Design. Sophia has been curating a number of very important projects there, and the ones she's going to talk about are Notes on a Return and of other spaces, where does gesture become event? Now, due to shortness of time in discussing the processes of setting up Notes on the Return, Sophia is going to pass around the publication that accompanied that exhibition for you to have a sort of look at during the presentation. Thank you very much, Sophia.
Thank you, Joe, and it has been absolutely a privilege to be part of this very stimulating events and a lot of food for thought. Actually, I was quite immersed into other speakers 9 years and tried very hard to bring myself back into my own Zoom. So I also would like to thank Gabriella and Phil for the beautiful organization of this event. Thank you. Okay, so I will just start. Sound and noise. Something is happening and it is live and dissonant. Linda's piece, Love Imposes Impossible Tasks, commissioned by Cooper Gallery to open the 12-hour Action Group International Symposium as a part of All Other Spaces, where Does Gesture Become Events projects, offers a set of possibilities for reflecting upon how the politics of a live act continually stake out multiple and often adversarial positions and timings. Inhabiting the body as a dissenting medium, this politics of the live acts underscores how we appear to others. An important catalyst in this politics is feminist thought and its contributions to thinking the possibilities of radical forms of relation between embodied subjectivities. Speaking as a curator, feminist thought is a line of flight to cite Deleuze in contemporary critical discourse. It moves to a rhythmic rhythm, endlessly proliferating discursive spaces and a different means to think and act otherwise against the normative conventions of gender and identity. A crucial aspect to this, as articulated by Hannah Arendt, is a space of appearance. For Hannah Arendt, politics is grounded by the acts of appearing to others. Politics is a public and a social space. It's not a private act. It always involves and importantly implicates others. Through focusing on two curatorial projects, Notes on the Return and Of Other Spaces, Where Does Gesture Become Event, I will relate some ideas and reflections on this space of appearance and the live and the dissonant in the performative practices of women artists. Both of Other Spaces and the Notes on the Return provided a context with which to critically focus on the inherent presence of the political in the act of appearing to others. Acknowledging the possibility of being overlooked, whether deliberately or tacitly, the performative practice of the artist included in both projects evoke different means and politics of addressing the other, and a key constituent to these politics is memory. Appropriating a concept of memory elaborated by Walt Benjamin, who translated Proust in Search of Lost Time into German, and Notes on the Return situated Benjamin's search as, quote, a space of moments and discontinuities, end quote, rather than as a sifting through of chronologies of events. History and, of course, memory is always present. It exists, whether as conscious reflection or document in this moment. This present tense dispels the apparent certainties often pervade within discourses of the institution and art history. This present tense, it is, as it is always now, is inherently fluid, shifting, and unsettled. It is an event. Notes on the Return worked with this strategic notion of the event or history itself as an ongoing life process of debating and exchanging. The works produced, whether in the guise of the critical essays, archival installations, live performances, or the scores it generated, was, or should I say, is an open-ended foray into the limitless discursive potential of memory that evades codification or being reduced to the status of an archive or static testament. As is often the case, particularly with live and performative works, the point of entrance to this discursive space of memory was via documentary and archival material. In the example of Notes on the Return, this material was what remained of the programming undertaken by Mike Collier in the 1980s at the LAN Art Gallery, Newcastle. That's where I worked before I moved up to Scotland, which included key figures of performance art, including Anne Bean, Rose English, Mona Hutton, and Rose Van Kelsey, Monica Ross, Bruce MacLean, and Nigel Roth, to name a few. One question that presented itself very early on in Notes on the Return was how these live works, 30 years later, occupied a liminal space that was not archival, but was indexed instead by physical ephemera, such as printed flyers and so forth, and the rare mention in art historical literature. Both of these points of entry to the works, whether as a chance discovery, which is in my case in the cupboard, or as a reference made in the text, indicate a marginal but always discursive zone. In retrospect, it is the question of the degree of access to this discursiveness of the works that determines the condition of their overlookedness, and access is the only currency that matters with respect to artworks, especially live practice. To return these works, not as a reenactment, but as a performative potential in the present moment, was not undertaken to rescue them from being overlooked. Instead, the intention was using curatorial methodologies to interact with the politics that fused the works, their method and the presentation, and importantly, the social dimensions that the works were and are immersed in. In this sense, being overlooked was not a quality of the works themselves, none of the artist, but a condition given to the social and the political realities that the works and the artists address and occupy. And it is a condition that mediates, to use Hannah Arendt's phrase again, the space of appearance by laying down different registers of visibility, legibility, and audibility. Produced by political, economic, and social conventions of what matters and what doesn't, the overlooked in this context is defined by a difference, which is given to the space, that the works discursively occupy. Aspects of this difference in all its registers provided the core material for the two chapter exhibition and event projects of other spaces, where does gesture become event? Radical, dissonant, and often wickedly subversive, the artists, writers, and thinkers inhabiting the different iterations of all other spaces, whether as an exhibition, an event, or a symposium, the 12-hour action group, or most importantly, as a live, discursive space, consistently navigated and questioned what can be seen, read, and heard. And it is this sustained practice that takes issue with the parameters, full stops, and the conventions that curtail our rent space of appearance. The key ambition of other spaces, though, was not to provide a survey or history of a set of practices and their politics. The intention was instead to provide a medium, i.e. the curatorial, in which the word, thought, and deed embodied by artworks, primarily performative ones, could be opened out to the critical demands of this particular present. Applying an expanded understanding of the archival and what constitutes art history, both notes on the return and of other spaces were a constellation of event. By event, I'm not referring to performances or symposia, but to the event as a rupture, a disjuncture, after which nothing is the same. The constellation itself is the act of scoring the innumerable potential relations between these events. It is, as I'm sure you can imagine, a live and a dissonant process. It may seem counterintuitive to link scoring and event. If the event is the unknown, a black swan, then what is the relation with scoring? Scoring here is used to describe a process and a space with no definitive point of closure. In this sense, the exhibition, the symposium, and the associated appearances of a critical curatorial practice, of which this event today is actually an example, are not ends in themselves. The overriding desire is for them to be live discursive spaces that traverse each other as a site of dialogue. Part of this method is a collapsing of different times and spaces into each other, for which feminist thinking is a provocative and a cogent mode of creative and a critical inquiry. An intention of this as a curatorial approach is also evident in the four-hour program of readings, performances, and audio works that marked the closure of the performance form of other spaces, featuring works by Anne Bean, Cheng Yao, Annabel Nicolson, and many others. Sadly, I don't have time to talk about them all today here, so I will briefly explore the ideas I have outlined through reference to works by three women artists. An internationally acclaimed artist, Cheng Yao, rose to prominence with her infamous piece, Opening the Great War, in 2001. Departing from the spectacle of that particular work, Cheng Yao of other spaces trod a circumscribed and repetitive path to escape the presence of others and the materiality of a durational action work. Using thick yellow tape, which she stretched up to head height, Cheng Yao stepped on the tape to fix it on the floor with her foot. Over 4 hours, a yellow outline of her path accumulated on the floor. Yet Cheng Yao's performative formalism retained a critical urgency that echoed Mary Kelly's 92nd film loop, WLM demo remix. It is this recurrence of the appearance of the female body as protest and a performative act delineates an open-ended duration. Both inside 1.58 square meters and the WLM, demo remix, claps, and fold time, leaving an always unsettled space in which what was done and what will be done continually cite each other. This continual return, which is not internal, but is instead a political necessity, was sustained when 9 women were invited from the audience to read a text, A Room of One's Own, by Annabel Nicolson and her collaborators, in front of Kelly's film and Cheng Yao's action. Referencing and recalling an exhibition of work and performance at Bracknell Art Center in the earlier 80s, in which Nicolson and other women artists were given 3 weeks in which to show any works they liked, the text mapped the conversations that were an important aspect of their process. Read aloud, decades later, the text drew the listeners in another shared moment. During the live reading, Cheng Yao, who was performing, paused, giving time to these other voices. This act of giving others not present was taken up by Anne Bing in 3 new works: Dialogue with Ruth Kelsey on Divisions of Self, Dialogue with Alexis Hunter on Feminism and the Erotic, and a Dialogue with Monica Ross on Life Drawing, Drawing Life. Intended as a femage, and being played on homage to women artists who are no longer with us, these new works set out intimate discursive space which re-witness the struggles of other times. Composed of crafted objects, printed emails, and an acacia tree. Is it acacia tree? Yep. The works acted as an arbiters onto carefully nuanced dialogues that interrupted, indicated, and opened up for reflection, a complex relational politics between the self and another. Being followed this groove in a different work, I Think You Move Me, So Come On Move Me Now, performed live for Of Other Spaces closing event. Positing her own past self as the other, this performance was a conversation between Anne Bing in 1972 and Anne Bing in 2017, with interruptions by Moody and the Menstruators, which is a collective all-women Nautilus band formed by Anne Bing in the earlier 70s when they were still at art school. This complex play of voices joyfully and loudly breathed life into Arthur Rimbaud's famous aphorism, I is another. Among these multiple twisting and turning dialogues that animated Of Other Spaces, the collapsing and the layering of different acts and the situations was a sustained refrain. This was wonderfully highlighted by 2 video works by Annabel Nicolson, Stock Exchange in 1983 and the Fire Film in 1981. Encapsulating the mode of politics that drew upon activism and protest, Nicholson's 2 works provided crucial demonstrations of dissonance and its necessity as a response to capitalism, i.e. stock exchange, and the nuclear weapons, i.e. fire film. But in both of these examples, the dissidence wasn't in an overtly confrontational register. For stock exchange, women lay down in all the roads leading to the stock exchange, halting the traffic through peaceful acts of abstraction. Nicolson recalled and celebrated this act by stating how a few women could achieve so much with such restraint, a timely riposte to contemporary street politics, which often quickly descend into violence, as we all could see these days. Both films stressed collectivity in any act that seeks to confront, subvert, or challenge a dominant ideology. It is this condition of a few dissonant voices coming together to make a stand that echoes throughout Of Other Spaces, which in lieu of examining feminist thinking through a conventional art historical context or the formal aspects of an artist's practice, focused on the often ignored or politically sidelined potential of collective acts. In retrospect of other spaces and the important voices and the works it brought into proximity, situated the political ethos of feminist thinking as an inherently discursive space, grounded in self-organization, alternative politics, and the collective effort. And it is this that my practice continually activates for. And to wrap up this talk and give a closing refrain to the artists and the works, I would like to read the last paragraph in Nicolson and her collaborators' text, A Room of One's Own. In order to write, produce art, a woman needs independence in terms of money and the physical space. Today, these requirements have been accommodated in the art system we all went through. Chosen people are allowed their own workspace on condition they act like artists and produce artworks. These spaces are never their own because what goes on in them is scrutinized by outside authority. And the artist, her activity and her work will only be seen in a way which will serve the existing structure. The system is based on competition. You have your space instead of someone else on merit. As a reaction against this, we wanted to work together. The objects in the room were not tied to the individuals who put them there. People said it was impossible to say where one woman's work started and another finished. The room we referred to was the communal space we gave each other. Thank you.